Look at how far Sean Oberg can give the lead. How far would you go?
Group D table looks after that result. Germany and the Czech Republic have qualified to go through to the finals of Euro 2008, and our campaign is definitively over. My gym is over long before now, I think, in many ways, but absolutely, mathematically, in every other way, we're gone. And we were lucky indeed to get a draw tonight. Look at the other results there. Germany and the Czech Republic is not finished yet, but the Czech Republic are three up. So that gives them the qualification. What have you got to say?
Well, that it was an embarrassing night for Irish football. We had a squad of Premier League players. They've been together 10 days. And bad mistakes were made in team selection tonight. Two in particular, Joey O'Brien and Andy Keogh, shouldn't have been playing in the positions they were playing in. The Cypriots really were the better side. They should have been maybe...
Five chances they had?
Yeah, they should have been three up. And Steve Finnan's goal is meaningless. In fact, the crowd see it, the whole country can see it. They sold 70,000 tickets tonight, 54,000 people only turned up. That means 16,000 people bought tickets for this and didn't show. The FAI will lose all their credibility if they don't do the right thing now. And the right thing is to go out and hire the best manager they can get, to spend the money and give us what they promised last time, a world-class management team. And we need to give these players, to be fair to them, not to be hammering them. They've worked and their socks off to keep him in the job. And tonight was very difficult for them. I'm not going to criticise a single player tonight. That's what I feel.
Jim said a disjointed mess, it lacked direction, it lacked composure, it was awful. And it's the manager's fault. Let's call a spade, isn't it?
No, but we predicted that before the game, Bill, you know. There wasn't any one of us here felt confident about Ireland winning the match by a two-goal or a three-goal margin. We knew the Cypriots were improving all the time. We knew from team selection and the personnel that we had playing, it might be a struggle, and it might be an embarrassing struggle, which it was in the end.
Did you expect, though, and John, I ask you this question, did you expect it to be this bad, that Ireland would be so bad?
I thought, Bill, it could be. It's hard to say you expect anything in football, but the way the Irish team are playing at the moment, the team selection, as I've said, it's hard to expect anything other than trouble. And we got trouble in abundance tonight.
Every match is worse, Bill. You know, it's getting worse all the time. And the players, the morale is being sapped from them. And that's the biggest worry with young players. Sorry, John.
Oh, sorry. I think when you get an inconsistency of selection, Bill, and you get, like we saw tonight, you know, O'Brien playing in midfield, you're going into the unknown, so you never know what's going to happen. But if you pick the team in such an inconsistent way, somewhere along the line, you get a performance like that. And it's not the first time we've had a performance like that. We're terrible in Cyprus. It was terrible in San Marino. So that's at least three
that's
of the games. So
yeah.
It's a look at the draw in the way the team performs on the night. In other words, nobody knows what's going to happen. There's no continuity from start to finish in the campaign. As I said before, the match, this is the second last match in this campaign. We've played how many matches? 9, 10 matches at the moment. I think that team, we should know that team without suspensions or injury, 11, before we go out on the pitch. No Keogh coming in from nowhere, O'Brien coming down. I know I'm going over old ground. But when you get that type of inconsistency, then you get that type of performance somewhere along the way.
Yeah.
And it's more likely to happen than not happen.
Now, can I be the devil's advocate for the moment? Because you will have seen this morning in the papers, and indeed yesterday as well, there was a kind of a strong PR campaign for Staunton. On the grounds that... He always said it was a 4-year campaign and only 2 years are up.
Now, can I answer
stop
that?
This nonsense?
No, hang on a second.
That?
I said I'm doing the devil's advocate.
Okay, can I answer that? Have you got your question then?
Yeah, Mike, the argument that has been advanced in his favour, and I want you guys to take it apart if that's what you want to do, that he has developed a whole series of new talented players who were not there when he came in.
Okay.
And that he's got a very good team spirit.
There we go, Bill.
Okay.
Sorry, Lynn.
I was always of the opinion, Bill, Eamon called it after the second game of the campaign, that he didn't think the manager was experienced enough to be leading a team at this level. And I said, well, let's have the campaign to be the judge of that. And let's see, can he learn along the way, as Mick McCarthy did. Because Mick McCarthy went close twice.
He did.
But got that experience before he led us to a World Cup. What the evidence is showing, particularly on team selection, no, I'll clarify that, only on team selection, is that the man is not learning along the way. He's picking the wrong players. He has picked the wrong players consistently. He's picked players in positions that are not their positions. So the evidence is, for me, that he hasn't learned along the way. And
the only conclusion is he should go.
Well, I think we've been of that opinion for a little while now. Nobody has been defending Steve Staunton or saying that he should carry on in his position.
But those who defend him say, well, he's brought in
Bobby
players.
That's Bobby Robson.
It's more than Bobby Robson, though. It's Given made the point.
Oh, well, yeah. Hold on. Players are in an impossible position. They cannot publicly attack their own manager. And they shouldn't publicly attack their own manager. But it's not even at this stage a question of attacking Steve Staunton. I said it on Saturday, I'll say it again. Steve Staunton was a wonderful professional player for Liverpool and for Ireland, for Aston Villa. And there's nothing wrong with Steve Staunton as a man. The responsibility for the mess that the Irish international soccer team is in now lies with the FAI. They are the people who are viciously spinning, blackguarding journalists, threatening them, and...
Have you evidence for that?
Yes, I have. Yes, I have evidence.
Have you personally been?
All the evidence is from the journalists who are close to the camp on a day-by-day basis, that it's an uncomfortable, intimidating atmosphere. And there is a vicious PR campaign going on to say that Steve Staunton is getting... And this idea, Bill, of a four-year plan... After 2 years, we can now make the assessment Liam suggests we should make. And the assessment is that it isn't only team selection. The organisation of that team tonight was wrong. At set pieces, we scraped away with a goal at the end. Everything about it was wrong. They were too far. They weren't up the back as a unit. There was too much of a gap between the back four and midfield. If you wanted to bore people and send them to sleep, you could give a tactical analysis, which would be just as damning. But we can't do that. We don't want to necessarily do it. We haven't got the facility to do that. But what we can say for sure is that you can't charge €70 a ticket and bring people from all around the country to this magnificent stadium to watch a guy learn a job. We're all on that train that was going to Corfield. But a lot of people are jumping off. And some people have paid €70 for their ticket, plus their children's tickets, and they're travelling from Monaghan, they're travelling from Galway, they're travelling from Cork. And they're committed to that team. They were wonderful tonight, the fans. And they were disgusted at the end. And they're right to be.
And they were entitled to be.
Because the wall is being pulled over their eyes by these people who are spinning.
Okay. John, you have managed the Irish team. Your judgment on this.
Well, I think the thing about the 2 years and the 4 years is nonsense, Bill. First of all, there's no such thing as a four-year plan in football, whether it be club football or international football.
So today's plan, is it?
But particularly in international football, where, in my opinion, the common sense thing is you pick the best players available for the next match. And then the team evolves over a year or 2 years as young players come through. Because you don't bring the young players through yourself. It's only the clubs in England, mostly the clubs in England, sometimes in Ireland, that actually produces the players. So you're not actually cultivating the players yourself. So the two-year plan...
But you're identifying them, though, John, to be fair to him. Like, he's identified certain players and he's brought them in.
Well, there's been loads of players being brought in, though. That's the problem.
But you've got to build
Too many players have been brought in. In other words, we should be hitting a team that is that's the best team that should play most of the time. That's the problem with bringing in the young players. But to get back to the two-year business, I think when Steve Staunton was appointed... My opinion, I was never in agreement with the Bobby Robson appointment, but I thought with Steve Staunton, okay, he's a player, we'll give him a chance. Because some players, like Roy Keane, for example, last year, come in straight away and did it straight away. And I think with players of international experience, they either have it or they don't have it. Obviously, the more experience get the better. So, but there's fundamental things that you can do as a manager without the experience. One of them is getting the team selection right and having the team well organised. And then you learn as you go along.
And he's not doing that, you say.
That's right. I think that after the first campaign, which has played 11 matches now, I don't see any evidence of any continuity and progress in that particular
team. There's
no
real experience in the staff, apart from Bobby Robson, who's not been well. But
No, no, should we have a coach who's a reserve team coach?
Reserve team coach. Obviously, yeah, Steve knows him well. Might be a very nice guy. Yeah. And now we've got Pat Devlin on the bench. And is he making a contribution? Did he play football?
So are we saying, that assuming we win in Wales, which isn't by any means a certainty, that if we stick with the same manager, stick with the same management team, that we're going to do just as badly in the World Cup?
Every chance. It's been a spin, as Eamon said, a spin of we're learning along the way, we've introduced young players. It's just a spin. We'll finish third, so our seeding goes up. What does that mean?
Well, it's better than finishing fourth.
Hold on, Neil.
Yeah, but is it a reason to go again?
Well, it's not
the
a reason
same
for celebration.
No, is it a reason to go again for the same?
I don't think so.
Well, the FAI were saying it was.
And
Were they, Eamon?
Yes, they were. And Slovakia are going to finish above us in the table. You know, this was a weak group. The Czech Republic are a pretty poor side. We had them live here about 4 weeks ago. They're a pretty ordinary side, Bill. Now, we should be qualified for 2008 finals, and we should have a team prepared for the qualifiers for 2010 World Cup. We're nowhere at the moment. We've demoralised and hurt our own players.
But Eamon, can I ask you one question? Are we overestimating these great young players that we talk about?
Right, no one's talking about great young players. What we're talking about is players who are holding their own and doing well in the Premier League. I'll give you an example tonight. The Robbie Keane-Doyle partnership, people are complaining that it hasn't worked.
Yeah.
Didn't work on Saturday, didn't work tonight. They had 10 days out in Malahide. That's where you make those partnerships between players that aren't used to play together work. That's what coaching is. It isn't a guy in a pub, Bill, or a train. Yeah, or sitting around and saying, we pick the names out of a hat, or this is my favourite team. Coaching is work. You go out and work with players.
And the work hasn't been done, you suggest.
And you need judgment. Okay. You need good judgment, and then you need to go and do your work. And none of that is happening. It's evidently not happening. Okay.
You can only go on the evidence of what you see, Bill. And so far, the evidence hasn't been good. And unless there was some sort of a miraculous improvement, in my opinion, for Steve Staunton's judgment and managerial skills, then you certainly couldn't be optimistic about going into another campaign.
Yeah.
And I'd be like Eamon. I mean, I think Steve Staunton is a smashing lad. He's been a great servant for Ireland, but you have to judge him as a manager now, and you have to judge him harshly and as honestly as we possibly can, and that's what we're doing. And so far it hasn't been good.
I have to say, though, it's an extraordinarily depressing night. We've got to take a break for the reaction and match analysis after the break, so stay with us. Well, we've got more soccer action for you this Saturday on the Premiership. Arsenal, Liverpool, Manchester United and the Merseyside Derby are all featured. Join us at 7:30 on RT2 for those games. Later on Saturday night, Pro Box Live returns to our screens. Two of Ireland's brightest prospects are in the ring. First up, Matthew Macklin takes on Alessio Furlan. And later, John Duddy meets Prince Aaron in what Duddy hopes will bring him closer to a world title shot next year. Join Darren Maloney at 10 o'clock for that event. Well, back here it finished, as you know, 1-1. And we've got the Irish manager, Steve Staunton, now. He's talking to Tony O'Donoghue. It's coming up. All right, OK. Be interesting to hear what he says, actually. He has to be disappointed himself, obviously.
Well, yeah, it's an ordeal for Steve Staunton at the moment. And, it's... He shouldn't be in this situation. He should never have been in the situation. He wasn't qualified to take the job. But now we're seeing the consequences, and the consequences are felt in really by the players and by the supporters of the team. Supporters spending their hard-earned money, the players who are on a career path. They deserve to play.
But can I ask a question that always intrigues me?
I'll give you an example of the spin.
Yeah.
Last week, Steve Staunton said there was a danger that players would stop turning up to play for Ireland if they were getting criticised in the media. In other words, anyone being critical is endangering the players coming here. Now, nobody in the media is really hammering the players. The people that have been criticised are John Delaney, who's responsible for the appointment, and Steve Staunton himself. Mm. And the questions are legitimate. But they are spinning like mad. I'd be very interested to see what he has to say, but I don't like to see a good football man in this situation.
OK, let's hear what he has to say. He's talking to Tony O'Donoghue.
What's a cock-up, this is?
I'll come back to the studio.
I'm sorry, we have some technical problems. We will sort them out, but we can't sort them out at this particular point in time. The thing that I find very hard to imagine, I think Delaney has done a magnificent job as chief executive in promoting the game at various different levels. I think structurally the FAI is in a better condition than it ever was. I think that things are being put in place that were never there before. He's done a wonderful job. Why doesn't he admit, against that background, that this was a mistake?
Well, I think it could come to that, Bill. I think what they said was that they'll wait until the end of this campaign, which is one match. I mean, we were advocated that Steve Staunton go earlier because give the new manager a chance to come in. But it's one more match to go now, and I think they will reflect on that. And I would be surprised if there isn't a change at that particular stage.
We have Steve Staunton now, so let's watch it.
Very poor performance. Very disappointing. And I can understand from the fans' point of view, it's not good enough, and it's not good enough from the players or the management team.
How much responsibility do you take yourself for that?
Well, you know, that's my job, but once the players go out over the white line, they have to stand up and be counted. They've done it on Saturday, didn't happen tonight, and, you know, we're all disappointed with the performance, never mind anything else. We've been very lucky to get out of jail tonight.
It was shocking, in fact, to hear an Irish crowd boo an Irish team here at Croke Park.
Well, they were within their rights. It wasn't good enough, as I said. You know, no excuses. First half, we never got to grips with it. Second half, a little bit better, but a long way off the standards.
Obviously, with Andy Reid being injured in the build-up to this game, you never really had a chance for that 11 to practice together, did you?
Well, no, but that was the same before Saturday, so there's no excuses there. And there's nothing you can do. I can't pass the ball for them, but, you know, we have to show a lot more desire than that.
With players like Joey O'Brien, it clearly didn't work in midfield to change him at half-time. It was a big ask for the young man.
Yeah, like Saturday, it was a big ask, but he coped very well. But, you know, he's a lot better on the ball than he showed tonight. But didn't work. We were still 0-0. And second half, as I said, Liam came in, done well. But, you know, we need an awful lot more.
Cyprus home and away, San Marino performance, the result in Slovakia, whatever about the performance. These are landmarks along the road. Does it make you question your own ability?
No, not whatsoever. I'll get on with my job and I'll see it through. I know what I've come here to do. And I've seen the young players coming through. We have to try and get a settled squad now for the World Cup. If we do that, we can get a settled team and then get players pushing other players for places.
I think that's very sad to listen to.
It is,
really, isn't it?
It's a touch surreal, but...
He obviously has no intention of resigning.
Well, I don't blame him. Why should he resign?
I think you should consider your position when it becomes as bad as tonight, Liam.
Well, why should he resign? The FAI gave him a contract for 4 years. Yeah, if the FAI want to get rid of him, they get rid of him and pay the man off. The man deserves paying off. As Amy said, he shouldn't have been put in this position in the first place.
Mm. I don't think
it's a question of payoff. I mean, I think I find it.
Well, it is if you resign, John. I'm sorry. It is if you resign.
It is sad, isn't it? He was such a great player.
He's been a great player, and he's up against it. He's had a dreadful time. He's having a dreadful time. But at the same time, Liam, I wouldn't rule out that if he feels that he hasn't done the job, you know, when he reflects on the situation tomorrow or next week, to say, look, I haven't done the job.
Yeah, it depends on the circumstances.
Isn't he saying, though, that the management has to be blamed as well as the players? But then at the same time, there's no question about his own ability, and there is no question of not doing what he was required
to do. He has to say that, Bill. You're not going to go on and say, look, I'm sorry, everybody in Ireland, I got it wrong.
Yeah, but John Toshek, now, after the match in Cyprus, made the point that he had to question what if he was doing things wrongly when they were
blamed the players as well.
He blamed the players as well. But he was more forthright about himself.
No, only after blaming the players, Bill. He blamed the players first. I think John Tashi's behaviour was dreadful on the weekend. At least Steve Staunton's done it with a bit of dignity there tonight, you know. And as Liam said, if you ask the manager right, he's not going to say, well, look, I did a dreadful job. He could say, well, I made a few mistakes along the way. But it is difficult, I think, particularly after a match like this, where he's had a dreadful, dreadful performance. And of course he has to accept responsibility, but it's a difficult time for him to
Toshak has said, Steve's had too little experience, Toshak's had too many. He's managed 100 clubs, but he's just better at the spinning. But this is a crisis for Irish football. I'll tell you why. If you take people like Richard Dunn and Shay Given, take two of them, Steve Finnan in his 30s, these guys deserve the best shot they can to play in a major championship final. The fans out there deserve to follow their team to 2008, 2010 in South Africa. There's something really serious at stake here. And all the fooling around and the lying and the spinning and all of that stuff has to stop at some stage. Now, as things stand tonight, John Delaney's credibility is shot to bits. They have no credibility.
In terms of disappointment only.
In terms of disappointment, but this is what is at the core. It's the dynamic that drives the whole game in this country. It's the highest aspiration of every young kid in the country to play for their country. People don't come from Galway and Cork and Monaghan all over the place to fill this magnificent stadium, Bill. That's what they come. This is at the core of everything. Yeah. And, responsibility has to be accepted. And a decision has to be made in the best interest of Irish soccer, not any individual.
Okay. We also have to acknowledge, of course, tonight, the performance of the Cypriots. And let's celebrate their performance by looking at their goal.
Yeah.
Which showed a lot of mistakes.
If you were a Cypriot tonight, Billy, you'd be a proud man. The manager must be well pleased. They went out, they played with plenty of skill, plenty of confidence. This is the goal coming up, which is an excellent goal from their point of view. Obviously, you can always look from a defensive point of view, which we were very, very poor. I mean, that's a free header inside the 6-yard line. I think it was Paul McShane lost his man in the when the ball went out wide. And look, he's got it. That's an absolute clear header.
Doesn't it demonstrate how important Richard Dunn is, though?
Yes. Well, he might have made a big difference there tonight, all right. But even Richard Dunn, Bill, on tonight's performance, I don't think would have stopped what actually
happened. Let's have a look at Finnan's goal. He took that well, didn't he?
He did. He went close a little bit earlier on. He had it blocked. It was sustained Irish pressure. Little chip in from McGeady. The Cypriots can't get it clear too far, and Finnan slams it in.
And it was interesting, I thought, watching him going back to the centre. He wasn't really celebrating.
Well, you're not going to be celebrating an equaliser in injury time against Cyprus, Bill. Come on, that's not. I think it does save a bit of embarrassment. It keeps us above Cyprus in the table, but. That would have been. I felt a bit sorry for the Cypriots because that probably would have been their greatest result of all time.
In all probability. Yeah. Okay. They could have had. They had five clear chances. They took one. Let's look at one other one as well. Ocas' chance.
Yeah. Ocas. He plays for Celta Vigo in Spain, and he really, really should have scored. He scored 21 goals for Cyprus, and this is very close. Clips the outside of the post. Shay Given did really well, but he got the wrong side of McShane. And it was the most clear-cut chance in the match, in fact. And that was their fourth chance in the match. They took their fifth chance, and they played very well. They had probably had more possession of the ball than we did.
Yeah, they had it one stage.
And they gave us a bit of a chase, and here's another chance here. Again, a late run in behind the defender. He was onside. He was played onside by Kevin Kilbane. Watch the late run. In fact, it's John O'Shea who plays him onside in the centre there. See, that highlights lack of organisation as well, Bill. You know, in that line, you have to hold that line. That's John O'Shea's job. Now, if Richard Dunn was there, a more commanding personality, he would have held that line. That player would have been offside. These are the things that matches turn on like that. Okay. And these are things you work on. This is why you take your coaching qualifications. This is why you learn to be an international manager. Okay. And this is what's been lacking with Steve Stoner. Nothing in his character. It's just a lack of experience of how to coach and manage at the highest level in the game.
Okay. All right. Let's finish though on a better note, I suppose, in a sense. Let's look at some Irish chances.
Yeah, well, we had our chances as well, Bill. And particularly from crosses. And this is Andy Reid. Reid had a good game tonight. There was a lot of misplaced passes from him as well, which was unusual after his performance on Saturday. But he does a great little dummy there. Good ball in his right foot. And Hunt, probably a little bit small to be able to guide it in at the far post. But that was a good chance. And then Doyle was switched out on the right wing, and he hit a tremendous cross in there. And Robbie Keane misses a golden chance. Nothing similar to the one he missed in the first half. And really, Robbie, he's had a nightmare a few days, hasn't he? He could have beaten Germany with the chance he got. when he was clean through, and he had two real good chances tonight, and you would have expected him to capitalise on them and finish them.
Before we close, Liam, isn't it possible that Ireland, England, Scotland and Wales will not participate in the finals?
Well, it looks like Scotland are in difficulty now after losing
2-0.
Wales
are gone.
And England, well, it's out of their hands now. Russia can do it.
Yeah. All right, that's it. Ireland's Euro 2008 championship has come to an end, and truth be told, it never really got off the ground, did it? It's all about building towards next year's World Cup campaign now, and manager Steve Saunton will already be looking ahead to that, beginning with next month's game away to Wales, and that's a fixture you can see here live on RTE television. But an awful lot might happen indeed before then. My thanks to John, to Liam and to Eamon for their thoughts tonight from everyone here at a very depressed Croke Park. Good night.